Well, Greg Rickford is the Parliamentary Secretary for Aboriginal Affairs, and he's with us now in studio. Let's just talk quickly about that court decision this week. Has your government decided whether it's going to appeal it to the Supreme Court?
Well, we're taking a close look at it, obviously. What the decision is about is a new group contemplated under Section 91, Subsection 2.4. Obviously, we're going to. It implicates a lot of things, not just for the federal government, but other jurisdictions.
Would you agree that it seems to be a pretty? I mean, if it's allowed to stand, it would fundamentally alter the relationship in a way that none of the political discussions that we've had there this week would.
I guess it could, Kevin. I mean, the decision didn't talk about the rights that would correspond. It simply focused on this group of people for the purposes of the Indian Act being defined as an Indian. We're taking some time to carefully review the decision, and I think you'll see us take steps in the not-too-distant future.
Okay, let's... overnight in Calgary, there was a blockade on the Bow River, one of the bridges there. And there are threats coming from some chiefs across the country of more disruptions to transportation lines on Wednesday. So far, the authorities have been keeping a hands-off approach on this. But is it your expectation that these kinds of blockades or disruptions should lead to charges?
Well, look, we respect the right of Canadians, any Canadian, for peaceful protest. Our expectation is, of course, that they stay within the rule of law. And also, Kevin, particularly as a guy coming from the Great Kenora Riding, where we have the Trans-Canada and major rail lines that that we don't get into public safety issues and jeopardize the lives of any or all Canadians. So that's where our expectations are. We're hopeful in these regards that none of this kind of activity will put Canadians in jeopardy, and obviously there will be an expectation that law enforcement will step in and ensure safety and the rule of law.
And apply the law?
Apply the law.
Let's go back to Friday for a little bit. One of the things we heard from Sean Atleo, which was pretty clear, was that he didn't want any more adjustments to the Indian Act going forward. He said that act is pretty much dead as far as First Nations are concerned. That has been your government's focus, to try to get what you can get done within the Indian Act. We didn't hear whether or not there was agreement to abandon that approach. Has there been?
Well, what there has been so far, obviously quite recently, the potential for some amendments to some rather archaic elements of the Indian Act that just should be gone. References to residential school processes for band council resolutions and different things that involve the need for the minister to sign off on each and every First Nation person's will, for example. But the challenge moving forward has been to create the kind of legislation that gets communities in and out from underneath parts of it. For example, we just announced new entrants to the First Nation Lands Management Act on Friday. This is building on a number of others that we've done each and every year. They get out from underneath one-third of the provisions of the Indian Act, deals with self-governance, gives them new tools for economic
But he doesn't seem interested in proceeding with that anymore. He wants to focus on treaty rights. So is the government decided that it will continue to pursue modernization of the Indian Act?
Any and all of our activities, Kevin, are going to be focused on the economy. We understand, and it's very clear, particularly out in regions of northern Canada, that whether we're talking about major resource or just full-on economic integration, Aboriginal Canadians and their communities represent the key components to creating jobs and creating healthy, more sustainable communities. That's going to be our focus. So whether we're talking about the Indian Act or whether we're talking about the treaty, the context that these have to take place in are certainty, finality, and the legitimate ability or outcome to create solid economical platforms for communities to move forward. Emphasis on education and training. To the extent that they fit into treaty discourse, they'll find us and have to be willing partners, and that was an important takeaway from our meeting on Friday.
One of the other takeaways was that this whole matter of treaties is being kicked up to the highest level in the country, to the Prime Minister's level.
That's right.
We haven't heard from Minister Duncan a lot during this process. Is the fact that this is now being handled by the Prime Minister mean that he no longer has the confidence in Minister Duncan to handle this file?
Absolutely not, Kevin. I mean, the Minister has been busy doing what Ministers do. Obviously, this is a big department, one of the biggest departments in the government. Minister Duncan has been busy not just working on files, for example, a couple of the announcements that we've made in the past week or two, which are a normal part of our activities and involve preparations and final strategies, water quality, for example, First Nations Land Management Act, but also he's been busy with his staff preparing for Friday. And so that's been an important exercise for him and his staff to go through. I've been part of that process, obviously, and I have all the confidence that the minister will continue to lead. What people aren't talking about is the fact that over the past year, we've brought forward a number of major policy platforms under water and education. The minister moves those big boxes. And he's been busy showing leadership in these regards as well as other pieces of legislation.
So. All right. Greg Rickford, thanks for being with us on this Sunday. We really appreciate
it. Thanks, Kev. I appreciate it.